always important. Bill Graham's funeral is, maybe if we could throw that slide up. Bill Graham's funeral is Saturday, and the arrangements are a little bit different. Not sure why they're like that, but they are. The funeral's going to be at 11 o'clock in the morning, and then there'll be a luncheon and an opportunity to visit with the family at 1. So instead of having the visitation ahead, it's going to be after, and you can have a bite to eat and whatever. And then at 1 o'clock or thereabouts, we're going to head for the interment at Fenland Falls. So just a reminder, and many of you know Bill Graham, just wonderful, wonderful chap. Great, strong faith. And his family, I met with his family this week, and his family were rather amazed at the connections and the influence that he has had on other people's lives. And I had an opportunity to tell them how Bill had impacted our lives here at KCC, and what a willing worker and what a ray of sunshine this man was. So let me encourage you to take the time to attend the funeral, not just out of respect for Bill, but as a witness to the family that he not only had a family, a natural family, he had the family of God here at KCC, and I think it will be such an encouragement to them, because my understanding is they're not all followers of Christ. And so I think if we can be there, not just for Bill, but to support the family as well, that'll be just wonderful. So we're going to start a series today. Scott mentioned earlier, called Stranger Things, and there are some really bizarre things that have happened in Scripture, particularly in the Old Testament. There's at one point there was a construction site, and there was an axe head that was floated up to the surface of the water, a steel axe head. There's a snake morphing Cain. There's a father who actually sent his daughter out, or is willing to send his daughters out, to be raped. Hard to get your head around something like that. There's name-calling teens who were mauled by bears. There's a wife who encourages her husband to have sex with another woman. There's a God-wrestling prophet. There's a discourse between a man and a donkey. And you got to scratch your head about how those things happen. There's a cowardly husband who claims his wife is his sister. There's the tale of the salty lady. And if you come to the Newer Testament, there's the two fantastic fish-catching stories, and we're going to look at one of those today. There's also a plot to kill a man who'd already died. Okay, so there's strange things in Scripture, and we're going to have a look at some of those things today, and just bizarre-looking things. Before we do that, we need to remember what Paul wrote to Timothy, because it applies when we look at some of these strange things in Scripture. Paul wrote to young Timothy. He said, "All Scripture is inspired by God, and it's useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong, and it teaches us what to do, to do what is right. God uses it, Scripture, God uses it to prepare and equip his people for doing every good work." Okay, so even though we're going to look at some strange things, we should be able to extract some truths and principles on how we conduct our lives and be encouraged by that. And one of the things that I'd like to do before we get going too far is to just reinforce with all of us what we need to do when we look at Scripture to understand what's going on, because sometimes it's really difficult. We look at a certain happening in Scripture and we just scratch our heads and say, like, what is going on there? So there's some things that we need to do when we encounter something that's not readily understood. And the first thing is we need to consider culture, and we need to consider context. And if we look back in the Older Testament, there's some cultural things there that are absolutely different than the world we live in today. And if we get our heads all wrapped up in saying, well, those things just shouldn't be, we miss the message that's there. And so some examples of some of the cultures that are in the Old Testament and were quite common in the Old Testament that we don't see so much today. And Tyler mentioned this a couple of weeks ago. It was fairly common in the Old Testament for men to be married to more than one wife. A foolish thought. Like, I can get into enough trouble with one. Okay? But that was fairly common in the Old Testament. Women back then had very, very few rights. Often marriages were arranged, and often arranged to benefit some people, not because they thought they'd be good husbands and wives. It was more a financial or a political arrangement, and that was fairly common back then. Slavery was common. Okay, even in the first part of the New Testament, slavery was common. So we can't get our minds all wrapped up in that stuff because it distracts us from finding out the truth. And then context. We really need to understand what's going on. If you just take one instance and try to understand that, it may not make sense, but if you go back two or three chapters and read what was going on, you say, ah, now I get it. And if you have a study Bible at home, study Bibles are really good because at the first part of the study Bible, for every book in the Bible, it gives you a little history. So good reading to catch up on what's going on. Second thing we need to remember is the difference between what is described in Scripture and what is prescribed in Scripture. Okay? So let me explain that. If something is described in Scripture, it's just helping us get a picture in our mind of what's happening. Okay? If it's prescribed, it's something that we need to do. It's like a doctor giving you a prescription, said, take this, it's for your own good. And so that's the difference between two. So some examples, if you look in the New Testament, you'll find at one point, Jesus was walking across the water, he approached his disciples who were in a boat, and impetuous Peter calls out to Jesus and said, tell me to come and walk on the water with you. And Jesus humors him. He said, come on. So Peter walks on the water. That's a described practice. Doug, don't step out of your boat unless you're at the dock, okay? So all that's doing is describing something that's there. If it's prescribed, it's something we should incorporate into our life. So, and often prescribed things are mentioned more than once in Scripture. And so one that's very common for us and valuable for us as we live our lives is to simply treat our fellow human beings exactly the way we'd like to be treated. And that's mentioned a couple times in Scripture. That's a prescribed piece of information in Scripture. So we need culture, context, need to differentiate between something that's described and something that's prescribed. So with all that, you can now leave and I'll just tell you what the Scripture... No, we're not going to do that. So we're going to look at a strange event this morning. We're going to apply some of those principles and we're going to see if we can extract some truths for us to live our lives. So here's the event. So on their arrival, this is Jesus and his disciples, on their arrival to Capernaum. Capernaum was kind of their staging area. That's their jumping off point. They'd been away for a while. Now they're coming back. The collectors of the temple tax had a question for Peter. So the temple tax, if you were a single male, and I think it's over 18 years old, you were required every year to pay a tax to the temple, not to Rome, but to the temple, and that was for the upkeep of the tabernacle and for the operation of the tabernacle. Actually, in Canada, we had at one time what's called a poll tax or a head tax. So single guys at one time had to pay a tax because they didn't pay property tax or anything. So this is simply to support the operation of the temple at that time. So on their arrival at Capernaum, the collectors of the temple tax came to Peter and they asked him, doesn't your teacher pay the temple tax? Yes, he does, Peter replied. And then he went into the house. So he's outside and he's come back to the house. But before he had a chance to speak, Jesus asked him, what do you think, Peter? Do kings tax their own people or the people they have conquered? Well, they tax the people they have conquered, Peter replied. Well then, Jesus said, the citizens are free. However, we don't want to offend them, so go down to the lake, throw in a line, open the mouth of the first fish you catch, and you'll find a large silver coin. Take it and pay the tax for both of us. So I got it? Got it all figured out? It's just a bizarre story. And at first, we just look at this and say, well, it is a great story. Who wouldn't like to go and catch a fish that has 4 days' wages in its mouth? Jesus' questions and his answers really seem a little confusing for the situation. And I guess the third one, you say, like, what on earth can I drag out of that story and that strange event that I could apply to my life? So let me give you some background, okay? Context. Jesus has 3 years to choose and train up his disciples because he knows he's headed for the cross. And if they're going to carry on after, he has to train them. And Peter is one of those disciples, and Peter's impetuous. If you read anything about Peter, you know that his mouth often gets going before his mind is in gear. And he's just impetuous. But Jesus recognized that in Peter, there was potential that probably Peter didn't even recognize himself. But Jesus saw that potential there. And often Jesus will see potential in you and I that we may not even be aware of. And his goal, Jesus' goal, is to bring all of his disciples and us to a point of absolute trust in him. If we were to look at Peter when he first encounters Jesus, and then compare that with Peter after Christ has been resurrected and gone to be with his Father, we see an entirely different individual. We see a man who was a common fisherman, all of a sudden preaching to a crowd of 3,000 people and doing it with great effectiveness. We see a leader that wasn't there before. We see Peter, who's not the impetuous one anymore. He's just a very wise man. And we have a couple of books in the New Testament that Peter penned. Huge difference, because he's been with Jesus and he's been trained up. And when you and I are willing to become fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ, some dramatic changes may occur in our lives. Probably will. Pauline and I are different people now than we were before we turned our lives over to Christ. We're absolutely different. Our priorities are different. Our lifestyle is different. The language that we use every day is different. Our finances are different. Our goals are different. Our future is different. Our understanding of life and death and what happens after we die is different. Our whole sense of purpose is different. Actually, it's not different, it's new. Because before we had Christ in our lives, we didn't really have a purpose. Now we have purpose and we live with purpose in our lives. So God has an individual plan for each one of our lives, and if we're willing to put our trust in him, then that plan can evolve. And when we're willing to put our total trust in him, he's going to help us. God will help us through the difficult times in our lives. So I want to look at some of the practical training that Jesus gave Peter that helped him to grow up and develop his trust in Christ. Peter was there for all kinds of miracles. He listened to Jesus' teaching firsthand. He had an opportunity to ask questions. He was there when the 5,000 people were fed with a few fishes, the same with the 4,000. He was there when, I mentioned earlier, when Jesus invited him to walk on the water, and then something really interesting happened, okay? While Peter's walking on the water, he takes his eyes off Jesus, and he sinks. And there's a good lesson there for you and I. Not that we should try to walk on water, but when we take our eyes off Jesus, sometimes things go south. He was startled. Peter was startled by some of Jesus' predictions on what was going to happen. In his own mind, he kind of had a plan for how he wanted Jesus to be, and he would be one of his followers, and Peter had this idea of how it all should play out, and he didn't like, at first, what Jesus was saying. He didn't like the idea of the arrest, and he didn't like the idea of the cross. And Jesus takes Peter and James and John, and he takes them up a mountain. And all of a sudden, Jesus' features change, and he's just glowing, and they're all astounded, Peter, James, and John, because they hear God's voice. God's voice said, "This is my Son, with whom I'm well pleased." What an astounding piece of information. What an astounding experience that must have been. All part of Jesus training up Peter to put his trust in him. And he struggled, Peter struggled when they came across this boy, a teenager probably, who was possessed by a demon, who would throw him into fires and sometimes into water. And even though Jesus had sent them out to heal people, and he'd said, you know, you have the ability to overcome demons, they couldn't cast the demon out of this boy. And they were startled when Jesus said, it's because you don't have enough faith. And it seems to me that what was happening is Peter and the other disciples were putting their faith in the ability that Jesus gave them to do things, spectacular things. But that's where their trust was in the ability, not in Jesus. It was in the ability and the gifts and the talents that he gave them, and that's what they were relying on. And Jesus' goal was to shift Peter's thinking from the gifts and the talents, shift Peter's thinking from the thinking of the Pharisees and the religious leaders at the time, who were all about rules and regulations. And Jesus just wanted Peter to put his trust in him. And that's what he wants for us to put our trust in him. So with those truths in mind, let's see what we can learn. First thing I think we can pull out of that is that you and I can trust God no matter what. Absolutely trust God no matter what. As Jesus was teaching Peter, it was interesting. He corrected him sometimes. He asked Peter questions sometimes. He challenged Peter. He encouraged Peter. And slowly, very, very slowly, Peter's thinking started to change. And his level of trust started to grow. And at first, this question that we encountered in this piece of scripture today really seems like a strange one. All of a sudden, Jesus says, well, what do you think, Peter? Do kings tax their own people or the people they have conquered? And at first blush, you look at that and say, like, that doesn't even make sense. What has that got to do with this whole passage? But see, his question was not about paying taxes at all. His question about who he is and who he was. Because, see, Peter knew the story that the king of the Jews was going to be born in Bethlehem. He knew all about that. He knew that the promised one of God would come with power and be all-knowing. And that kind of fit with Jesus. And all of a sudden, in Peter's mind, this light come on, said maybe the king that he's talking about himself here, Jesus talking about, maybe that's who he's talking about. He's identifying himself as a soon-coming king. And then to sear that revelation into the fisherman's mind, Jesus once again demonstrates his power. Peter throws his line into the water, just like Jesus said. And he hauls up a fish, just like Jesus says. And he opens the fish's mouth, just like Jesus said. And he extracts a large coin that's the equivalent of 4 days' wages, just enough to pay the temple tax for him, and just enough to pay the temple tax for Jesus. What do you think would happen to our faith in Christ if that was to happen to us? Like his faith in Christ and his trust in Christ must have just taken this giant step forward. Slowly, slowly, his trust in Jesus is solidifying. God has a plan for each one of us to bring us to that place of absolute, total trust, so that life can be different and we can have an impact on those people around us. And God will use us in different avenues to help, or he will use different avenues to help develop our faith and help us to grow. I'd like Jamie and Jason Walters to come up. Jamie and Jason have been part of Kawartha Community Church for quite some time. They have fostered a bucket load of kids. And I'm going to sit in the chair, so we're eye to eye here, all right? So, mic to your chin. How many kids have you guys fostered?
11.
11 kids. Over how many years?
Three.
3 years.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And you folks, since Pauline and I have met you, you folks have have lived in a number of different houses that you have rented, but something's different now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Last year we were finally able to buy our first home. So we were it was a long wait. We were getting kind of frustrated and a little bit desperate. And we're like, how are we going to break into our own house? Last year it all came together. It was kind of a miracle how it all came together. We still pinch ourselves.
So talk to us about some of the things that God has used over the years to help build your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ.
Crisis.
Okay, all right, explain that.
We seem to need crisis to really keep our eyes on God. We get, when we don't have a crisis, now we're trying to change that. When we don't have a crisis, we get a little...
complacent?
Yeah, complacent.
Get comfortable,
and so when we have a crisis, we are forced to put our eyes on Jesus because he's the only thing that will get us through.
Okay. So could we create some for you to help you go faster?
Please don't.
Now, you host a small group. Talk to us about how that small group has helped you guys grow in your faith and your trust in Christ.
They're very good to come alongside us and share our troubles and our joys and come up with a plan in times of trouble and different things we can try, and we can, and they share their experiences and ours with them, and come up with a plan and
accountability.
And they say, oh, so you tried this, how did it go? Or you don't want to not try it and then have to answer, well, why didn't you try it?
Okay. Other than a crisis, okay, what if you were to say, okay, here's some things that we have found worked or some suggestions that we can make for the rest of us here on how we could grow in our faith, what advice would you give us?
We were actually talking about this just last night because we leave everything to the last minute. And... we each kind of have a Bible verse that we just go back to, and you can kind of, whenever you're wavering, we just kind of, each of us on our own, just you can repeat that in your head. And it happens to be different. Our Bible verses are different for each of us. And I think part of what our small group does for us too is that they turn us back to Scripture all the time. Okay. And when we're not in the Word, it's, you know, we sink. Yeah, we sink because you forget. So, and I think part of what has built our faith too is looking back on when we've been in crisis and seeing in retrospect how God pulled us through is just, it's incredible. In the middle of it, it's hard to see that, but on the other side, and we are always come out the other side. And he just, when we look back at that, it's just incredible. Yeah.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much. All right. Take care. Why don't we give him a hand? Well, just imagine. Imagine if you could have total peace in your mind when the difficult times in life come. And we're all going to face them. We're all going to have tough times in our lives. Imagine if you could just have peace in your life. Imagine what it would be like to not panic when a major decision came up in your life. To not be laying awake at night, to not be stressed out by that, to not be panicked by those things. Imagine what it would be like to access wisdom that you know comes from God, godly wisdom, when you really are not sure what to do. Imagine being able to trust God to guide you and help you in life's challenging times and in life's quieter times. Imagine what that would be like. I mentioned Bill Graham earlier. I visited with Bill a number of times after he got the news that he had inoperable cancer, and Bill knew he was going to die. Bill had superb faith and trust in God. And even though he knew he wasn't going to make it, Never, ever once did I ever sense any distrust. Bill knew where he was going. He knew he was going to die. He knew the end was coming. And yet, his faith never, ever wavered. Never. And I mentioned that to his family when Pauline and I were visiting with them this week. And I thought it would be an encouragement to them. And Heather said, early one morning, Bill phoned from the hospital. And he was a little weepy. And he's saying, I'm not sure I like the prospects ahead. And then that was one statement. And his next statement, it says, I'm just feeling sorry for myself. I know where I'm going. And that was the end of that conversation. What superb faith that he understood all about life and all about death and had his faith totally, totally in Jesus Christ. Been rereading an interesting book. A book is called The Power of Change. And in part of that book, there's a couple chapters about overcoming destructive behavior or destructive thinking. And we probably all have a little bit of that in our lives, whether we have negative thinking or whether we have habits that don't go well, things that don't go well. And they had three things that seemed to be important when they talked about the power of change. One was to identify the cue or the trigger to a destructive habit. So if you're a smoker, or if you drank too much, or if your anger got out of control, the whole idea was to try to identify the trigger that set that off. Okay, what caused you to go and have that drink? What caused you to have that next cigarette? What caused you to blow your stack when you're conversing with someone else? And then the second step they said was what you need to do is to take your normal response to that and modify it to a more positive action. Okay, so you modify your response, and then thirdly to establish a suitable reward. So that if you have the urge to drink, rather than having a drink, maybe you go and make yourself a sandwich, or maybe you go and cut the grass, or maybe you do something. So that's modifying the response, and then you decide what you want after it. Whether you sit and read a book, take 15 minutes time out, read a book or whatever. Anyway, that was what they said worked. Then they talked about Alcoholics Anonymous. And Alcoholics Anonymous, probably many of you know, not just three steps, they have 12 steps. But they're doing a similar thing, okay? They're identifying a trigger and they're modifying the response. So if you're an alcoholic, you know what triggers your response to have a drink. And the modified response was, instead of having the drink, you phone up your sponsor and you talk with your sponsor, okay? And then you have some kind of a reward. And Alcoholics Anonymous has been really, really effective over the years. And so they did some studies on why it was so effective, and then they found out that there were some people who were really doing well because they quit drinking, and then there was, and that was great, but there was this small percentage up here that they had quit drinking for 3 months or 6 months or 2 years, and a crisis would occur in their life, and they're back drinking again. And so they said, okay, let's see if we can figure out what's going on there. So they interviewed a whole mess of people who had been successfully stopped drinking, hit a crisis in their life, and went back, started drinking again. And you know what they found? The big thing that wasn't there, that was there with the people who were successful, is belief in God. They had this belief in God, everybody else, that God would take them through. And he would help them with the help of sponsors and the weekly meetings or whatever meetings they went to. But they also had this belief that God would take them through. The ones that failed in crisis did not have that understanding. What a startling revelation. So how do we go about building that trust? Well, let me give you some suggestions here. We can form a trust habit simply by finding a quiet place every day and talking to him and just ask him, help me build my trust in you. Help me along in this journey. And then we can develop that trust habit in those quiet times by taking one of the first four books in the New Testament and reading through and just letting God help you understand what is there, and that you're developing that faith and that trust habit. Then reinforce that trust habit by But in every challenging situation that you come across, before you do anything else, simply say to yourself and say to God, I want you to help me through this. Before you do anything, just reinforce your faith to say, I want God to help me through this. And then finally, solidify that trust habit by before you start any planning or decision making, pray for God's decision and wait and hear from Him. So form the habit, develop the habit, reinforce the habit, and solidify the habit. And when we're willing to make the changes, to trust God unconditionally, our ability to handle life will improve dramatically. We lean on God, He'll walk with us through those challenges in life. He has promised never to leave us. He's promised never to forsake us. God is willing to help us if we're willing to put our trust in Him. There's a saying that we use sometimes at Christmas, sometimes at Easter, and it said, God is good, and then there's response. So the leader might say, God is good, and the congregants might say, all the time, and then the whoever's the leader at the time might say, all the time, God is good. And I want us to modify that one this morning, and I want your help. So, okay? So we're not going to say, God is good this morning. We're going to say, God is trusted. That's my words to you, and your words back are all the time, and then we're going to reverse that. So let's try that, okay? So God can be trusted all the time. Absolutely, you got it. Okay, so what else can we learn this morning? Second thing that struck me in this whole passage is that building positive relationships open doors of opportunity. One of the most important things that you and I can do is to step into the opportunities that God gives us to display our faith in Him, to perhaps talk about Him, and to steer other people into a relationship with Jesus Christ. And often those opportunities to do things like that only come when we've developed a positive relationship with people. One of the worst things that we can do is to slam the doors of opportunity closed by offending people. Jesus said to Peter, we don't want to offend them. So go down to the lake, throw in a line, open the mouth of the first fish you catch, and you'll find a large silver coin. Take it and pay the tax for both. Well, why? Why would Jesus pay that? Say that? Simply because he knew that unlike some of the Pharisees and unlike some of the religious leaders at the time, there were many Jews there, including probably this tax collector, who were going to put their faith and their trust in God. And he didn't want to offend them. Because when we offend people, they don't listen to us very much. Let me give you a couple examples. One, a negative example, and then a positive example of how this whole thing can work. Many of you know that midlife, not a crisis, but God's calling, I left the job I've been at for 20 years and answered God's call to ministry. And one of the ways that I supported our family was I worked every summer as a production supervisor at the Baskin-Robbins production plant here in Peterborough, and one of my responsibilities was to hire summer students. And so I hired a bunch from the Bible College. And we had one chap that I wish I had not hired. So this is 35 years
ago.
Culture was different, not like today. Culture was different 35 years ago. So if you went into the lunchroom where most of the male employees had their lunch and they went for their break in the morning and the afternoon, you would find one wall papered with fold-out Playboy pictures, okay, of scantily clad women, and that's the way it was. There were a few female staff, once in a while they would come into the lunchroom, but mostly that was a male-dominated room, and that wasn't all that uncommon for that era. Well, anyway, this one Bible College student, second day in the job, ranted and raved in the lunchroom about the Playboy pictures that were up on the wall. And I'm thinking, good grief, like, we are here for 4 months in their territory. Okay, and 2 days later, he was telling them all that they were all going to die and go to hell, and that they needed to have Christ in their life. And I looked over at the one follower of Christ who worked there, and Terry had his head down, and he was just shaking his head like, what is this guy doing? And it got worse because they realized they could spin him. So they asked him all sorts of embarrassing questions, and I go in the lunchroom, and it was like I was a referee at a prize fight. And they'd be baiting this guy, and he would pick it up every time. And they made fun of him, and they just spun him. And there was zero chance for this guy to ever make a positive impact for Christ. Just zero. Let me tell you another story. This one is about a pastor that I've known for quite a while. Whenever he went and does go into a restaurant, the first thing he looks for is a name tag. And from that point on, he will call the waiter or the waitress by name. And if there isn't a name tag there, it's not unusual for him to go and see if there's just walk by one of the other employees and say, what's his name or what's her name? And he makes a point to call them by name. He also makes a point when he's finished his meal to leave a generous tip. And if he has been served well, he will see if he can stop by the manager and say that Mary over there was our server this evening, our waitress. She did an excellent, excellent job. Just wanted you to know that. And he would tell her the same thing. Turns out after a while, this one waitress found out, asked him what he did for a living. And he told him he was a pastor. And she said, well, I like having you in here. So this pastor was telling the congregation one morning, just using it as an illustration like I am here today, that if we're going to have a positive influence on people, there's some positive things we can do. And he said, I've tried to be pleasant with her. She's an excellent waitress. And he said, I tip her well. And he said, who knows? Someday she may show up here because she knows I'm a pastor here. And he just got finished saying those words. And there she was. There she was. And so she had a chance to hear through the preaching, and she came on Sundays, to hear about Jesus Christ. He never offended her. He was very pleasant. What are the opportunities that you and I have to simply be nice to people and not offend them? And I think if we can learn anything from this lesson this morning and from what Jesus is saying is, we don't want to offend people out there. Because who knows who may come to faith in Jesus? Who knows who's having a bad day, and you and I can simply step into their lives. So two things to take home to this morning, that God can be trusted all the time. God can be trusted, and always be courteous because it preserves opportunities for God. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for everyone who's here this morning. Lord, I really pray that what we've talked about today will kind of roll up in our minds later on this day and this week, and that you will help us to put our trust in you, that you will help us when we interface with other people to build positive relationships with them for the sole reason that that's what you would have us to do, is to treat them the same way that we'd like to be treated. And I really pray that through our actions and through our trust in you, that you can use us for your glory, that things in our lives would go better. And I really pray that we would be able to connect with other people in a way that at some point we could talk to them about what it means to have Jesus Christ as part of your life. I pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. We're going to give you an opportunity to ask some questions. Scott will tear the mic around. So if you have any comments this morning or some questions this morning, stick up your hand. Okay, Jeremy, don't forget, hold the, it's a dead duck. All right, you got to holler really, really loud, okay?
All steps with celebrate recovery as well.
Okay.
We have the 8 principles that go with it. So I'm glad that you mentioned that, because I know we have a program, there's even a program here in Portland where people wanted to go to check it out, that's a good place to get some spiritual input.
Okay. So there are a number, Jeremy's mentioned that there are a number of different programs that have different steps. Alcoholics Anonymous has 12 steps. There are some other programs that have some steps that are out there, and good solid programs and excellent. Okay, other comment or question? I realize a little difficult with. Okay, all right. We're gonna show you some quotes that hopefully will reinforce what we talked about today, and we're gonna send the baskets around. The two colored baskets. The first one, they're a light colored basket. And they'll have offering envelopes in there. There's some pens. If you need to use those, you're welcome to take those out and put your offering in. If you're visiting with us today, the expectation is that you don't put anything in the offering basket, the darker colored ones, when they come around in a minute. You're our guest today, and we would like to treat you that way. If you decide to make KCC your home church, then obviously we would consider that you should support us here. So the light colored ones are coming around first. The darker ones, when they come around, you put your envelopes back in. If there's a response card in the first ones that come around, if you want to be on our mailing list, then pop that in the darker colored ones when they come around, and let's have a look at some quotes here.